Hey, good morning, everybody. This is Tuesday, May the 19th, and this is our daily word of encouragement. I'm so thankful that you guys are continuing to join in this with me every day, and hope it is doing exactly what it was intended to do, and that's to be an encouragement to you. It's exciting to see that so many things are starting to get back to normal. I know as a lot of that's happening, there are many people that are hearing that news and excited on one hand, but kind of nervous on the other hand, just concerned that people getting out and about and around one another, that that's going to create the opportunity for this virus to kind of catch on again and have some kind of resurgence. And so it's definitely understandable to have an appreciation for all the different emotions that are going on right now that people are experiencing. There's a kind of a desperation to get out of the house and to get back to normal, to get back to work, to get back to experiencing life as we've gotten, you know, that we're so accustomed to. But also to be respectful of those who are concerned about their vulnerability to this virus. As somebody who's had a family member who ultimately succumbed to this virus, is certainly something that we take seriously as well. And so there's just a lot of different emotions going on. As with anything that gets emotional, when you get emotions involved into it, sometimes you can get people that can be very can create a lot of opposition. They can get the issue can become very divisive, and we're seeing that. And it's a shame that over a health crisis like this, that is creating such divisiveness in our government officials and in our just in the general population, that it's almost becoming like a political issue in some ways of people who tend to side on one side or the other, having this difference of opinion. And it's just a real shame that in this whole spirit of, hey, we're going to get through this together, and this is going to be something that we'll have to deal with as a nation, as a community, and as a people, that again, this, like so many other things in our culture, can become so divisive amongst each other. And so how do we respond to situations like this as the church, as followers of Jesus Christ, and on any issue that can become easily divisive? We, a lot of times as a disciple, we ask ourselves, well, what would Jesus do? And I think it's a very appropriate question to ask in this situation of how would Jesus respond? What would his attitude or his perspective be? How would he kind of frame the situation? And how would he engage with people in a way that would show wisdom, but also grace at the same time? There's a passage of scripture in the book of Colossians that as Paul was, the Apostle Paul wrote that letter to the Colossian church. And as he was beginning to close that letter out, he gave some instructions to the Christians there. Colossae, the city, was a very difficult place to do ministry, as were many of the cities where Paul planted churches. It was a very cosmopolitan city. It was a trade city. There were a lot of different cultures that passed in and out of this city. And so you had a lot of different worldviews and viewpoints that were present, even amongst the Christians there and the church that had started in this area. And so Paul wanted to be very mindful about the way we engage with each other and about how you can be respectful of somebody, even if you disagree with them, because if you're not, you can ultimately just close a door, and you can you see people kind of putting up walls, and they'll refuse to hear anything that you have to say or be open to anything that you might want to share with them from the heart. Because you just shut them down or closed off any opportunity for dialogue to take place. And so these words from Paul, I think, are very poignant for us today and important for us today to keep in mind, not just in this current crisis, but in the way we engage with people in every aspect of life, in the marketplace, in the workplace, in our schools, as we encounter people in the community, and certainly in the social media atmosphere as well. We need to keep these guidelines in mind for the way we encounter each other. So Colossians chapter 4, begin reading in verse 2. First of all, Paul is asking for the Christians there to be praying for him in the way that he engages with others. He says, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. He actually wrote this letter from prison. These next two verses, though, are really important. Paul kind of asked that prayer for himself, but also for collectively for the church and the way that we engage in conversations with people. He says, pray that I might proclaim it, being the gospel, clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. I'm going to read that last verse again. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. That expression, seasoned with salt, is an interesting one. Salt, back in the first century, had a lot of different values and uses. It was used to preserve meat. It was used certainly to increase flavor. It had a lot of value, actually. It actually, there was the word that we have, salary, actually comes from the word for salt. Not that people were paid in salt, but it was seen as something having great value back in that time and that culture. So let your conversations be always full of grace and seasoned with salt. When we put salt on food, it definitely gives it flavor. Sometimes something can be very bland and difficult to kind of get down. You add a little bit of salt to it and it gives it flavor, makes it more engaging and tasty, and people want more of it. It creates, and it can create thirst as well. And I think there's a lot of application into what Paul's saying here and the way that we use our words. The way we use our words and what we say, and more importantly, sometimes how we say it, is critical for getting God's truth across, both through sharing God's truth, but also just reflecting God's truth in our normal actions and speech with other people. And then the fact that he says, let your conversation be full of grace, that when you're speaking to other people, when you're encountering other people, whether you're talking a conversation or you get into an issue that may have the potential to be divisive, the admonition to those of us who follow Jesus Christ is that our conversation would be full of grace, not the spirit of judgment or of condemnation, but of an attitude that seeks to build and create a bridge, who seeks to open doors, not shut them, to kind of break down walls, not build them back up. And so the challenge there, I think, to us, and I mean, that I take personally, is what is our speech typically doing? It's okay, certainly, to have strong convictions. We absolutely should. We were called by God's word to stand for God's truth and to be steadfast in that. But the manner in which we do that, the manner in which we defend our faith, is really critical if we're going to seek to fulfill the mission that Jesus Christ gave us, which is to go and make disciples of all nations. We should hardly expect people who don't follow Jesus Christ to have a Christian worldview. And if our immediate reaction is to build walls instead of building bridges, instead of trying to find common touch points or find common ground with people to be able to build relationships, to build trust, then we're going to be very ineffective in accomplishing the mission that Jesus Christ gave us to seek and save the lost. So in this current dilemma that we're facing, I would just encourage you, it's okay to certainly to have an opinion when that's an opinion or an idea that's based upon facts, upon actual information, not just your gut or your personal intuition, but to leave room for to be gracious in your response as well. And when somebody views differently from you, you don't know what their background is, you don't know what their experience is. You don't know if they've been personally impacted or if they have health issues and concerns that they're afraid maybe realized through all this experience. And so in this current crisis, to be gracious in your response. We want to operate and deal in truth, but also that we leave room for potential for there to be disagreement, and that we can talk through issues without seemingly having to take two opposite positions or be divisive. And I think if we'll model that well through this current crisis that we're facing, I think that's it becomes practice for many other issues and conversations that can easily become divisive in all the other areas of life that we face. So I hope that's a word of encouragement to you that you'll take to heart and put into practice, and that we will follow Paul's admonition here to look for opportunities to be created through our speech and our interactions and our conversation, not for walls to be put up and for relationships to be shut down. So let our conversation be full of grace and seasoned with salt so that we will know how to speak and answer everyone. Let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for your presence in our lives, and we thank you for your grace that covers our sin. And Lord, as we abide in that grace, I pray that we would always remember that we indeed are sinners saved by that grace, and we would have no hope beyond you. So Lord, with that mentality and that humility, I pray that we would approach everyone that we encounter in life, whether it be personally, physically, or through social media, or whatever format it may take, Lord, and have that same spirit of graciousness about us that you showed to us through your son Jesus on the cross. And we love you, Lord Jesus, and we pray these things in your name. Amen. God bless, guys. Have a blessed day.